Hello and welcome back to Oh So Retro, and also to part 2 of this free ewaste PC build. In the first part of the video, I took a whole bunch of ewaste and some parts that I got for free, and I used them to build a retro PC that anyone could conceivably build for pretty much nothing. Now, if you hadn't seen that video, then you can click the link at the top of the screen. But what I thought I'd do in part 2 of this video is have a look at what we can actually do with this PC. More specifically, I'm going to be looking at just how well this retro PC can game and whether or not it's an enjoyable experience. Obviously, onboard graphics are not great for 3D, but we're going to be taking a look at some older 3D games and seeing if those can be played with a decent frame rate. I'll also be looking at a bunch of 2D games from the late 90s, which are very popular amongst retro gaming enthusiasts. And finally, I'll be looking at a few upgrades which you could potentially throw into this computer to give it just a bit of a boost to its overall performance. But again, the focus here is going to be on keeping things cheap. We don't want to go out and buy expensive retro hardware to put into this PC. We want to see if we can get some decent upgrade performance for relatively nothing. But before I get into that, I want to have a look at what exactly the onboard graphics on this board is. As I mentioned in the first part of this video, this is actually an S3 Savage 4 on board, or more specifically, it's the S3 Pro Savage 8A26. And like I also mentioned in part 1 of this video, I do have a discrete S3 Savage 4 graphics card, this one. This is a AGP card, it's a 32 megabyte version. The onboard version only uses 16 megabytes, so we're going to put this in later as well and just see if it makes any difference to the performance. I'm not expecting any miracles in that regard though. So with that out the way, let's get into it. So the first game we're going to be playing here is the one that you've seen running in the background, and that is of course Carmageddon TDR 2000. Now this is by no means a good game. It's probably one of the worst, if not the worst, entries in the Carmageddon series, but it's still a game from around the year 2000, and it does present a pretty good test of 3D performance for this era of game. And as you can see in the picture here, it's not running great. The frame rate is pretty low. It's probably barely playable, but it's not something that I would recommend. It's not enjoyable. So in this case, I think the onboard graphics card is not quite up to the task of playing Carmageddon TDR. Next up is Mobile One Rally Championship by Magnetic Fields. This is a game that was released in the end of 1999. It's a fairly light game as far as system requirements go. And you can see here that it actually is running fairly decently on the onboard graphics. Having said that though, the frame rate is only between 15 and 30 frames per second on average, so there's definitely a lot of room for improvement here. Next up is Need for Speed High Stakes. This is a game from early 1999, and I'm pretty sure this runs on the same engine as Need for Speed 3, so the performance between this and Need for Speed 3 will probably be very similar. And so in this case, we see that this older Need for Speed engine is actually running very nicely on the onboard graphics. We're getting around 30 frames per second, which is pretty playable by anyone's standards. So this is actually a nice game to play on an onboard graphics card like this. The next thing that I wanted to try was some first-person shooters from the late 90s. And so first up was Quake 2. However, there seems to be an issue with the OpenGL support on this particular card. It might just be the drivers, but when I did try and use OpenGL in Quake 2, I got this white screen, which wasn't promising. And then when the game actually did run, there were no textures. So something's definitely broken here. The Quake 1 engine, on the other hand, had no such issues and seemed to run perfectly fine when I tried Half-Life. I unfortunately forgot to measure the frame rate here, but it was running really smooth, so I don't think you'd have any trouble playing this with the onboard graphics card. Staying with the first-person shooter theme, and I decided next to try Unreal, and this actually also ran really well on this onboard graphics. Again, I forgot to record the frame rate here, but you can see that it's actually pretty smooth, and in terms of what it's like when you actually start playing, it seems to be perfectly good. Smooth, it runs fast, There's no issues here. I didn't play too much of the game, unfortunately, to see if there were any slowdowns, but initial impressions were very promising. And now onto the final 3D game that I decided to test, and that is, of course, Homeworld. This game, like the others, was released in 1999 by Sierra and developed by Relic Entertainment, and was a gorgeous looking real-time strategy game set in space. In terms of performance, Homeworld ran pretty much better than anything else I tried on this integrated graphics card. I was getting between 30 frames to 50 frames per second. I think the game is actually locked at 50 frames per second because it wouldn't go higher on any graphics card that I tested. But it certainly was a very nice, smooth experience, and I think you would be very happy playing this game on this graphics card. Finally, to finish off the 3D tests, I decided to run a synthetic benchmark in the form of 3D Mark 2001. And while that's going on in the background, let's have a chat about this onboard graphics card's performance. So at this point, you might have noticed that I'm pretty much sticking to games from before the new millennium, i.e. before the year 2000. And there's a very good reason for that. Because onboard graphics cards are always far weaker than their discrete graphics card brothers, we really don't want to try any games that were released in more or less the same year as this board's year of manufacture, i.e. 2001, because that is very much the territory of the discrete graphics card. An onboard GPU is just not going to handle that. Here, for example, is what happened when I tried to play Black and White, a game released in 2001, on the onboard graphics. It's pretty miserable, horrible frame rate. This is definitely unplayable. But that's not necessarily a problem when it comes to a retro gaming PC, because in general, the kind of games we want to play are pre-2000 anyway. Everything from your classic point-and-click adventure games by LucasArts and Sierra under MS-DOS, through to Doom and Quake 2, your first-person shooters, Half-Life, and then even real-time strategy games like StarCraft, Warcraft, Red Alert, Homeworld, for example. Those are all generally the kind of things that people like to play on a retro PC. And this old AMD Duron system with its onboard graphics is actually perfect for that. You can turn off the CPU caches and make this into a 386 if you want to play really old stuff with MS-DOS. It's because it's an S3 card, it's got fantastic compatibility with MS-DOS games. And yet because this is a later chip, it actually has significant 3D horsepower for first-person shooters and other 3D games like Homeworld and Quake and Quake 2. So this really is a great all-rounder in many respects. But anyway, now that 3D Mark has finished running, we can have a look at the score, and it's very low, 747. That's pretty pathetic. But it is what it is. Shame, it tried. So even though the onboard graphics 3D capability is pretty limited, there are still plenty of games from the late 90s that ran in 2D and that you can still enjoy on a PC like this. Things like StarCraft, Fallout, and Diablo 2, which all ran perfectly well in software mode and were more than playable. It should also be noted that Diablo 2 does in fact support 3D acceleration, and the onboard graphics could also run it in 3D accelerated mode with a frame rate around 25 frames per second, which was fine. Not fantastic, but it's playable. So for the final part of this video, what I thought I'd do is have a look at some potential upgrades I could put in this computer just to help boost its performance. We've already said that this PC is in fact great as a retro PC as it is, and that you don't need a lot of graphics horsepower in order to enjoy retro gaming, but these upgrades could just help you if you wanted to play something a bit more modern, some games from around the early 2000s that the onboard graphics just can't cope with. I've also included a few sound cards so that we can get some better audio out of this PC. The onboard audio for the most part is perfectly fine, and I'm by no means an audiophile, so I don't really pay too much attention to sound, but I'm just going to show you a few options here that are readily available and that would certainly help to boost the sound quality if that is what you wanted. I must also mention at this point that these are all upgrades that I have paid a bit of money for. They're not free, but they were all very cheap for the most part. There isn't anything special here. There isn't any rare vintage hardware that I had to pay you know, hundreds and hundreds of rands or US dollars for. So this is all stuff that's just fairly ordinary and the kind of thing that if you can't pick it up for free, then you can certainly pick it up for a small amount of money. So let's start with this S3 Savage 4 discrete graphics card. This is the same chip, as I said, that's basically on board, except it's got more memory. This is a 32 megabyte version, whereas the onboard is only 16, and that's got shared memory. This is a card that I picked up purely for interest sake, and I paid about 50 Rand for it, which for international viewers is about $3, so not much at all. In terms of performance, this card did way better in 3D Mark 2001, scoring 1138, which is actually a 52% performance increase over the onboard version, if my math is correct. Having said that, the performance is still not really noticeably better in games. Where I noticed the biggest change was in Quake 2. The white missing texture issue was gone, and I could actually play the game at a decent frame rate. And so for Quake 2 at least, this is a good upgrade. With all the other games that I tested, there was no appreciable increase in frame rate. The games that ran well on the onboard still ran well on this, and the games that didn't run well on the onboard, like Black and White, still didn't run on this. The one ace that this card does have up its sleeve, however, is support of S3's Metal API. There's a great video on Phil's Computer Lab about this, and he shows off the great compressed textures that you can use with these cards in Unreal. I'll put a link to his video in the description below, but as you can see, it looks pretty amazing. The textures are incredibly high res using the Metal API. And while it's true that the onboard S3 chip can probably also do this, seeing as it's the same chip, you might want to put in the discrete version to get slightly higher frames and more memory for textures. Moving up to the next step in performance, and we have the NVIDIA Riva TNT2 family. This is a TNT2 Ultra. It's made by Diamond, and it's a 32 megabyte card. This is actually a really nice TNT2. It's the top of the line model, as far as I know anyway. If you can find one of these, then that's fantastic, but even if you can't, then the other cards in the TNT2 range are still perfectly good. Here we have a TNT2 M64. Like the Ultra, this is also a 32 megabyte card. However, unlike the Ultra, this only has a 64-bit bus, which makes a big difference in performance. It's also clocked slower than the Ultra version. So while it's nowhere near as fast as the Ultra, this should still provide a big performance increase over the onboard and the discrete S3 graphics card. And sure enough, when I reran the games on the TNT2 Ultra, I saw a significant performance jump, with much higher frame rates in Rally Championship, Unreal, and Carmageddon TDR 2000. Hell, the TNT2 could even run Black and White, which is pretty impressive for a card that would have been 3 years old at that point. I also reran the other games such as Quake 2, Half-Life, and Homeworld on the TNT2 Ultra, and it easily handled those games, but I decided not to include the results here because we were already getting pretty decent frame rates on the onboard graphics card in those games. So needless to say, if you have a TNT2 Ultra, you're going to be able to play all of those games perfectly well. And finally, for completeness, I ran 3D Mark 2000 on this card, and it got a score of 2,866. So yeah, that's about 2.5 times faster and 3.8 times faster than the discrete Savage 4 and the onboard Savage 4, respectively. And now on to the last card that I wanted to look at as a potential upgrade. It's the GeForce FX 5200. Now, this is one of the most reviled graphics cards of all time. And for good reason, it was pretty rubbish even when it was new. But because this is a more modern card, it's from 2003, I was thinking that it would be pretty quick because even a budget card from 2003 might very well be faster than a good card from, say, the late 90s. Another thing that I really liked about this graphics card was that because it was a budget card and because it was so unpopular, these are very, very cheap today. In fact, you can pick them up for virtually nothing. And also, because they were included in many budget PCs, they are readily available. These two factors alone seem to make this a really good combination for the cheap ewaste PC. And even though there are many, many, many better cards from around the turn of the millennium, things such as the GeForce 2 or GeForce 3 or GeForce 4 for that matter, or ATI Radeon, like the ATI Radeon 7200 pictured here, those cards would be way more expensive than the FX5200, if you can find them, of course. Which probably isn't going to be a problem if you live in the UK, as you can see here, or even in America. But even in somewhere like the UK, the FX5200 looks like great value, going for as little as £4 in some cases. But unfortunately, when I came to test this card, I discovered a whole bunch of rather weird behavior. Initially, things looked really good, and I ran 3D Mark 2000 on the card, and it seemed to be handling this test really very well indeed. It was getting 90, 100, sometimes even as many as 150 frames per second. And at the end, the score was pretty impressive compared to the other cards, scoring around 4,400 3D Marks, which is more than 50% faster than the TNT 2 Ultra. However, this is where things started to go south pretty quickly. I noticed in the other games that the frame rate was absolutely abysmal, with Need for Speed High Stakes, as you can see here, running at 8 frames per second for some reason, or indeed even lower in some cases. With other games like Homeworld running pretty well, getting a fixed 50 frames per second for most of the time. And Unreal was also pretty smooth, getting between 35 and 50 frames per second, which was far more in line with what I was expecting from a card like the FX5200. But clearly there was some issue with this card and those other games. So to try and fix it, I played around with different driver versions. I tried some older Nvidia drivers and some newer Nvidia drivers for this card. And I even went so far as to reinstall Windows XP completely and do a fresh, clean install of the latest drivers. But none of that actually fixed the issue. In the end, I managed to get hold of the actual LeadTech drivers for this card because I've had issues with LeadTech products in the past where they don't work very well with the generic drivers. And these drivers did actually seem to help quite a lot, and I got a massive performance boost in games like Need for Speed. Well, when I say massive, it went up to 20 frames per second, which is much better than 8. But as you can see, there were these weird blue lines all over the screen here, so there's obviously something still broken here. It must be said though that some of these lines weren't visible on the CRT, they were only visible on the capture. The performance in Mobile One Rally Championship also went up quite a lot, but again, massive image corruption on the screen, and the frame rate here was not actually that high anyway. It only went up to about 35 frames per second on average, so that's not much of an improvement over the S3 onboard or the S3 Savage 4 card, so it certainly isn't worth it in this case. And finally, in 3D Mark 2000, the performance was better, but then again, there's some image corruption here and these weird purple textures all over the mountain. So at this point, I was running out of time to get this video done, and I was sick of messing around with this particular card, so I just decided to give up on it. So I suppose my takeaway message for all of this is that you should probably stick to a graphics card that is more or less the same age, maybe a little bit newer than the system that you're building. If the card is too modern, you may very well have compatibility issues with older games like we had with this FX5200. But because this build is dependent on essentially free parts, you can't always choose what you're going to use. So if you do have an FX5200 lying around that you've managed to get somewhere for free, then by all means try it. It might very well work. It may just be the case that this particular model, this LeadTech, just has bad driver compatibility or something, and you might have better results. Finally, I just want to say a quick thing about sound cards here. These are a few sound cards that I managed to find in charity shops and from people online for very little money. The onboard audio is fine, as I said before, but if you want something a little bit better, better audio quality, 5.1 surround sound, that sort of thing, then you can't really go wrong with Creative Labs. Either of these two Sound Blaster Live cards would make a great addition to this ewaste PC. And all of them are still pretty easy to find, and they're certainly not expensive. I think I paid 20 Rand for these cards at a charity shop. That's about $1, maybe $1.5. So they're certainly not pricey at all, and they would be a massive upgrade to the onboard sound. And even if you can't find one of those, then you may very well be able to find one of these. This is a Soundblaster CT4810. I've seen these come up pretty often. It's sort of a value orientated Soundblaster card from the late 90s. And these are also pretty inexpensive, and they would almost certainly be a nice upgrade over the onboard sound. They probably also have pretty good compatibility with MS-DOS if you ever wanted to use this machine for MS-DOS gaming. Whereas I'm not too sure how easy it would be to get the onboard sound working under MS-DOS. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to test that for this video. But anyway, that's pretty much going to be it for this video, guys. If you've watched this far, then thanks so much for sticking around to the end. I know this was a bit of a long one, but if you liked this video, then feel free to leave a like. And if you'd like to see more of this sort of thing in the future, then please subscribe to the channel. And until next time, cheers, guys.